Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Welcome to the Puyallup Seventh-Day Adventist Church. We invite you to stand as we praise and worship our King.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made.
Good morning. I don't have to say anything. That just said it all. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. I'm just going to touch on a few of the announcements. The first one is the police bags. We only do this a couple times a year, so I just want you to recognize that if you do want to help contribute to that, just mark on the tithe envelope, and just write police bags on it, and then we'll know that that money goes towards the police bags. I have been helping with this for a few years now, and I'm telling you, those policemen are so grateful and so full of fun when we bring the bags to them. They really enjoy it, and they really are just so appreciative of our church to do that. Being a policeman isn't the biggest, greatest thing in the world right now. My nephew is one, and it's a hard job, so let's just say thank you, and a little bit of extra money in the offering, we'll appreciate that to go towards the police bags. The church directory, if you haven't done the church directory, I know you've heard the announcement for the last few weeks, but I just want to let you know that if you come to church, you don't think you're a member, you're not baptized, you're not a member in this church, don't worry about that. If you're coming to church on a regular basis, please go and get your picture taken. Jerry will be out in the hall, and come get your picture taken, give her the information so that we can get to know you. I can't tell you how many times I look in the directory each week because I know that name, but what do they look like? I don't remember what they look like. So it's a great, great device for helping to put a name with a face. So please, even if you're not a member, but you come all the time, please just go out and get your picture taken and get put in the directory. So that's a really important thing to do. Camp meeting is coming up. We all know that. We are all excited about camp meeting. They both need people to participate or to help, and they also need people to sign up if you need a tent or if you're going to get use part of the facilities there for something. Now is the time to sign up for that. Let's see. We have a first reading for membership transfer. Transferring out is Randy and Patty Sandvik to Alaskan Conference at the SDA Church in Anchorage. So that's our first reading for them. And that's the last announcement I think I have to make. I am supposed to say this. Today we want to hear you all sing. So when when they're singing, please add your voice to the songs that we're singing today. Oh, no, I know that. I was going to ask you to come up. I said, I'm done.
He's going to come.
He's coming. And Pastor, would you please come up and make a few announcements?
You served my authority.
No, I was not trying to. So tomorrow is our ladies' tea. There's going to be some gentlemen wearing something about like this. So the gentlemen that are going to be coming and helping to serve, it's going to be a really fun time for the ladies. Gentlemen that are helping me wear black shirt, black pants, so we look like we're actually in a tux of some sort, I guess, to look fancy and just treat the ladies a little bit. And Tracy Blue is going to be the speaker. It should be a really fun time. And next week, we have communion coming up here a little later today. Next week, though, is our ministry fair. And our ministry fair on Friday about 5 p.m., I'm going to start setting up tables for those that want to really decorate it up. If you are a ministry leader and want to decorate your table, we'll wait till after school care is done, and around 5 p.m. we'll be setting up tables all around in the gym, and it should be a really fun time. Next week, we'll also have potluck next week in the midst of that, so just a reminder for that. And yeah, enjoy the singing, and thank you for inviting me up.
We know he's Johnny on the spot. You don't invite him up, he comes up. All right, let's have a quick word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for this Sabbath. We are so grateful for the love that you shower down on us each and every day, each and every moment of our lives. When things don't go right, when there's sadness, when there's concerns in our lives, Lord, sometimes it's hard to turn to you, but we need to recognize that each and every day, all we have to do is turn to you in prayer, and you are there loving us and filling our hearts with joy. So Lord, please, as we go through this Sabbath and this Sabbath morning in communion, Lord, help us to really focus on you. We ask these things in your name. Amen. Remember, sing.
Would you be free from your burdens?
God will hear you.
Offering today is for the local budget, church budget. How many in here have a budget? I learned early on in my life you can't do anything without a budget. So for all of those you haven't raised your hand, you've got problems. You need to get a budget. My 21-year-old niece, or granddaughter, has figured that out. She called me the other day to talk about her budget, and she had it on a spreadsheet, and then in the corner she had her charge card. And I said, why isn't the charge card a budgeted item? She goes, oh, that's in flux all the time. Is that all my word? No. So the Lord does not want your budget to be in flux all the time. He He doesn't want our local church budget to be in flux all the time. So the way we can really help support that is to figure out what you're going to do to help our budget. And it needs to be a line item. The church is my first line item on my budget. If that goes in first, and then everything else comes out. Now, the problem is, what do you do when you get to the bottom and your paycheck has run out and you still have budgeted items? Something's got to go. Don't ever let it be the church to let it go. But that's an easy one to let it go. I have something it's a bookmark that I had from a long time ago, and it's called Tidbits and Wise Counsel. And one of them says, faith always affirms more than reason can support. Reason tells you, oh, the church won't, you know, lots of people are given to that. So if my budget's a little short this month, if I don't give to the church or give my tithe, it's okay. The Lord will forgive me because he realizes my situation and they'll figure it out. So just think about this. Faith always affirms more than reason can support. So go ahead and give that little extra to church, and you're going to find out. Reason says it's not going to work out, but the end of the month will come and you'll have enough money. So please always support your local church budget and the other church offerings. Will the deacons please rise? Remember, the children will be coming around with their baskets. That will be for the building fund. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, please help us as we go through this Sabbath and as we think about the offering for today and how important it is for our church to have the money it needs to run every week in a nice, comfortable manner. Lord, we're all part of that. We're all part of the reason why that works, why we have a comfortable, warm, cool church. So, Lord, just help remind us of that and remind us that faith will affirm what reason cannot support as we give our money this today for the church budget. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning, young people. Can you say good morning? Thank you. Listen, who's the most important group of people in this church? You guys are. You know how I know? You know how I know? Jesus said that. He said those young people are the most important people there are, to have them come to heaven with me. He invited you to go to heaven with him. Because he said that's what the heaven's going to be like, is a bunch of young people like you. So I would like to have our church give these young people a big hand today. See, they love you. Now, you're some of the youngest ones in our church, and what do you think I am? I am one of the oldest. So that's good. That works out good. This story I'm going to tell you partially took place 80 years ago when I was about 5 years old. Is anybody here five? Four, five? How old are you? 11. Oh, my goodness. They get old quick. Anyway, I was about 5 years old, and the year was 1941. We moved from a little apartment down in Tacoma. How many know where Tacoma is? We lived in Tacoma, and my dad bought 5 acres of land with an old farmhouse on it out in Spanaway. And we took our little toys. Hi, buddy. How you doing? We took our toys with us and our things. We didn't have a lot. And we moved out to that farmhouse. And one day we were playing upstairs in the attic. This had 2 bedrooms downstairs, had a bathroom, a kitchen, a dining room. And then upstairs it had 2 unfinished rooms where my brother and I slept. And it was unfinished because the walls had nothing on the inside except you could see the 2x4s. And my dad came up one day and I was playing with a train. And he said, well, you kids aren't very smart. If you play close to that wall over there, you drop that train down the wall, it's going to go clear to the bottom and I'm not going to get it for you. I said, what? If he hadn't told us that, I probably would have never done it. But sure enough, a few days later, I'm playing over there by the wall. I don't know what made me do it, but I dropped that train, and it went all, I heard it go down, plunk. And I said, oh, no, there goes my train. My dad wouldn't get it for me. Well, I thought I'd never see that again. But then 40 years later, in 1981, that I went out by that house, and wouldn't you know, it burned down that week. And everything was burned down except that one wall. And so I got out of my car and went over there. Nobody was over there. And I was looking around, and all of a sudden I hear somebody say, hey, what are you doing back there? I said, you won't believe me if I told you. And then I told him the story about my train. Oh, he said, my son found that yesterday. I said, is that right? Would he sell it to me if I found him? And he said, I think he would. I said, where could I find him? He gave me the address, so my wife and I drove out to Yelm. And there that little kid was sitting on the front porch waiting for me to come. How much do you think I paid him for that train? You're right on the money. $5. I said, would you sell me that train for $5? And the kid said, yeah, I'll do that. So I bought that train and I went home with that train. I had my little train back 40 years later. Now the moral of the story is this. Sometimes when you pray about something, the Lord will say, yes. Sometimes he'll say, no. And then sometimes he'll say, you'll have to wait a while. It'd be nice if I had that train here today, wouldn't it? Well, what do you think of having this bag here? There's my train. Look at that. Probably 100 years old. There's my train. You want to look at it? You want to look at it? Well, that's a vintage toy. So anyway, thank you for listening, and you can go back to your seats now. Thank you.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. It's good to see you all here today on this lovely day. Wonderful weather out there. A few months ago, Jasmine and I were just having a normal day, and we received a text message from a family group chat, and we were given an opportunity to see if we wanted a puppy. One of our family friends or family had a little dog that they couldn't have anymore, and they were trying to find a place to give it away. And so me and Jasmine were like, oh, that's very interesting. You know, we love dogs. This is a good opportunity for us. The only problem was we only had one day to decide. We had to decide by 8 o'clock that night, and it was already about 12 or so when we received the first text message. And so me and Jasmine, as indecisive people like we are, we went back and forth over and over again. One moment we'd convince each other, we probably shouldn't get a puppy right now. You know, we have a lot of things going on. Maybe a puppy isn't the best thing to do right now. And the next moment we're like, oh, but look how cute this puppy is. We cannot say no to this puppy. And it would go back and forth. We'd convince each other one way, and then we'd convince each other the other way, and it would go back and forth all day long. And my family was just kind of texting, like, I wonder how long it's going to take them to decide. How close to the 8 o'clock are they going to bring this to? And finally, around, I think, 6, we were a little early, we decided we would get the little puppy. And so we got a new puppy named Bean. So Bean, she's a doodle. And as we've been raising her, managing her, keeping her out of trouble, we've noticed that she can be a bit of a scaredy cat. She gets scared of the randomest things. She'll have a friend that she's seen over for lots of times. All of a sudden, the friend is setting up a pickleball net, and it's the scariest thing in the world, and she'll be barking and running away. She'll be out in the backyard just having a good time in the sun, and a plane will go overhead, and she'll get scared and run back into the house all afraid. She gets scared over the littlest things and sometimes the most random things. But I think it makes sense for the most part, right? She's only about 5 months old right now. And then as she grows, she's starting to learn a little bit more, right? She's starting to understand the world. And as she begins to learn and know the world around her, she begins to get less afraid. And I think that's true for most of us. The fear of the unknown is a major thing for us. We fear what we don't know. We fear what is to come, what is ahead of us, the future ahead. We fear things that we don't understand. We fear, just in general, things that don't make sense to us. We fear what others might be thinking about us because we don't know what is going through their head. But as Bean begins to learn the world around her, as she begins to know things, right, she learns that maybe that plane, she doesn't know what the plane is, but she learns that that big noise the plane makes isn't going to hurt it. It's not there to harm it in any way, and she can learn to not fear those things. Fear does a great job of casting out, or knowledge does a great job of casting out fear for us. But it's not the only thing that does away with fear. Sometimes we can have great knowledge. We can know that riding on a plane is safe, but there can still be that fear in the back of the head. What if this is the one time it's going to fall, right? I know the odds of being in a plane that's a crash is like 1 in 11 million. I know those odds, but what if I'm that one person, right? Like, the fear sometimes persists even though we have knowledge, right? You can think of horror or scary movies, right? I'm not a big fan of them, but even the people that are and love to go see them, they know movies are not real. They know what they're seeing on the screen is not going to harm them, but when something jumps out at them, they can't do anything to be scared and fearful. Sometimes the knowledge isn't all it takes to do away with fear. Many of us live with fears that we know deep down are not grounded in anything, right? I grew up with having and dealing with anxiety and social anxiety, and I knew deep down that most of those thoughts and those fears weren't based on anything, right? When I would hear people laughing behind my back, a lot of my times I'd be fearful that they're laughing at me for some reason. I knew deep down that it probably wasn't me, right? But those fears persisted, and it takes lots of practice, lots of training, lots of tools to get rid of those fears. And so we see that knowledge is a great thing of getting rid of fear, but sometimes it also takes practice. It takes doing to get rid of fear as well. And so today I want to look at how fear of the unknown can impact our relationship with God. How so often in our lives today, we fear God. We don't know who God is. There's so many things about God that are a mystery to us, that we can't comprehend, and it can scare us. Not only that, our picture of who God is is different for all of us, right? When I talk about God in this room, I imagine it's probably a fairly similar picture for most of us, right? We're all here on Sabbath for some reason. We probably have a picture of God similar to something in the Bible, but it's going to vary for each of us still in this room. And as we go even further to the city of Puyallup, it varies even more, right? God could be a vengeful, judging God. God could be a person that started the world and then decided, I'm just going to go leave it. It's up and running. I'll just go do my own thing. God could be just some spiritual being that they don't know. There's so many different opinions of who God is. And so today I want to look at who God says he is, who God is, and how learning and knowing who God is can cast away our fears. And we can put into practice what it is to know God and to live like God. We see knowing God is a crucial thing. Jesus says in his prayer on Gethsemane in John 17:3, he says, "And this is eternal life, that they know you." This is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. To know God is eternal life. I imagine it will take eternity to know fully what God is like. It will take even us getting to heaven before we can fully comprehend the Trinity, fully comprehend just who God is. It will take us an eternity to know him, but to know him is eternal life. To be in a relationship with him is eternal life. We grow closer to him. The more we know about God, the closer we are to him. The God we worship, the God that we serve, the God that you picture in your head changes so much about how you live your life. If your God is a judgeful, vengeful God, you will probably live a little bit judgeful, a little bit vengeful. If your God is angry and waiting to just smite you down, you'll probably be looking at others and waiting for them to smite them, to harm those around you. But if your God is a God of mercy, if your God is a God of compassion, of love, then you will also live a life of love, of mercy, and compassion. To enter into that relationship is eternal life. And on the flip side, we see probably one of the scariest verses in the Bible, Matthew 7:21-23. This passage says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of the Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name drew out demons, and in your name perform many miracles?' And then I will tell them plainly, 'I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. I never knew you.'" To know God is eternal life. And to be known by God is eternal life. We need to be in this relationship with God where we know him and he knows us. And so today I want to look at what God says he is, who he is, and what he is like. So let's pray before we begin jumping into the sermon. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, you are an amazing God, as we will find out. Lord, each and every day we learn more about you. And so, Lord, I just ask that you will open our eyes to what you have to say, that you will grow us closer to you, that you will reveal yourself in a new and special way today. And Lord, as we just remember your sacrifice today, that you will allow us to apply that knowledge and just live a changed life in you. In your name we pray. Amen. In the beginning of the Bible, especially the first couple of stories going through Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God doesn't really have a name. It sounds kind of odd for us to say, because God, for most of us, is his name, right? When you say God, that's his name. But in those first couple of stories, there's not really a name given to him. And you see oftentimes he's just referred to as the God of this person, the God of Abraham, the God of your fathers, the God of this, and this. And it goes on that way until we get to Moses and the burning bush. And this is basically the first time that God says his name. And we see this story as Moses approaches the burning bush. He's questioning God, and he's trying to find out any excuse he can to not go back to Egypt, to not be this leader. And he says to God, Moses says to him, "Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your fathers has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name? What shall I tell them?'" Right? He's kind of scared. He's saying, if I go back to them and just say, "Oh, I saw this dream from the God of your fathers that I need to do this," it'd be like, what are you talking about? Right? Who is this God you're talking about? Who do I tell them sent me? And God replies, saying his name for basically the first time in the Bible. God says to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites, I am has sent you. And this might be even a stranger name than just God. I am who I am. It's an odd way to have a name, but it is a very powerful name. I am who I am. What I was in the past, I will always be. I am a God who was in the beginning, and I am a God who will be at the end. I am a God of eternity. I am a God who stays consistent. I am a God who is who he says he is. I am who I am. Moses gets this name from God, and he finally gets the courage up to go back to Egypt, and he has this whole story. But there's lots of ups and downs in the stories of the Exodus, as I'm sure many of you are aware of. And it comes to the point where the Israelites have disgraced God. They've turned away from him right after they get the covenant. They're getting the Ten Commandments, and they set up a golden calf, and they just turn away from God completely. Moses then has another conversation with God where he has very similar back and forth with him here, saying, God, are you really going to be with me? How do I know you will be with me? And we see this in Exodus 33. He's questioning God. He says to him, if your presence does not go with us, do not send us from here. How will anyone know that you are pleased with me and with your people unless you go with us? What else will distinguish me and your people from all the other people on the face of the earth? And I just want to take a side. This is a beautiful prayer. How much would this be? What would it look like for our church to be known in this way? To only be distinguished by having God with us. Be like, to have you with me is the only way people will know we are different. I pray that this is our church today. That we will be distinguished from all people because God is with us. That they will know that we are a special group of people because God's presence is with us. And God says to Moses, he says, okay, I will do this. And he says to him, I will do the very thing you have asked because I am pleased with you and I know you by name. And then Moses said, now show me your glory. God knows Moses. God knows him deeply. He says, I know you by name, right? It takes away the fear of that first verse in Matthew where he says, I never knew you. God knew who Moses was. And Moses says, now show me your glory. Show me you are here with me. And so God says to him, I will cause my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. God then goes on to say that he cannot see my face, for no one who sees me will live. But he says that I have a spot next to me that I can hide you in this rock. So he gives them a few more instructions, and he says, come up to the mountain, and I will take you, and I will hide you in, and I'll pass before you. And in the next chapter in Exodus 34, 4 through 8, we see this. Moses, he cuts the two tablets to replace the first Ten Commandments. And like the first, he rose early in the morning and went up on Mount Sinai. And as the Lord had commanded him, he took in his hand two tablets of stone. The Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there. And he proclaimed the name of the Lord. The Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, a God of mercy and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. The Lord passes before Moses, showing him his glory, showing him who he is, describing his character, saying his name, Yahweh, Yahweh, a God of mercy and grace, a God of slow to anger, of compassion, abounding in steadfast love. It is a beautiful text, and it is the most quoted Bible verse by the Bible. So many biblical authors quote back to this verse. They either quote it directly, allude to it. It is the John 3:16 of the Old Testament. Everyone quotes back to it. Everyone in the Bible knows this passage where God is describing himself. And it's interesting to note how God is describing himself. If I were to ask many of you, what is God like? If I were to look that up onto Google, who is God? What is he like? I don't think it would be this verse. A lot of times, the first thing that comes to our mind are the omnis, you know, omnipotent, omnipresent, omniscient. We talk about how powerful God is. And while they are true, it's a weird way to describe someone. Imagine I asked you, what's your friend like? What's your spouse like? And instead of talking about their personality, their character, you said, you know, they can bench this much weight. They can run this fast. This is their IQ score. They may be true facts about them, but it's a weird way of describing someone. And yet we do that to God all the time. We say, God is all-powerful. God did this. God is this. We give off stats for God. But we miss the personality of who God is. And God says, I am merciful. I am gracious. I am loving. I am slow to anger. I am patient with you. God continues and he says, keeping steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgressions and sin. And most of the time we try to stop there. We try to end the verse there and say, wow, what a good God we serve. And we try to skip over this last part where he says, but who will by no means clear the guilty? Visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children and the children's children to the third and the fourth generation. This last part of who he's saying it is, it kind of rubs us the wrong way. It almost seems disjointed from the rest of it, right? God's merciful, God's slow to anger, but I'm going to punish the innocent children to the third and the fourth generation. That mistake your great-grandfather did, I'm going to punish you for it. It doesn't make sense to us. It kind of rubs us the wrong way. And most of the time, we just try to leave it out of the verse, out of the quote in general. We say, God is merciful, God is gracious, and we leave it at that. But God included this. He said it for a purpose. God gave his glory, and this was a part of his glory. So how do we make it make sense? How do we understand the two together? How is God merciful and gracious, yet visiting the iniquity of the fathers to the children and the children's children? We see a few different keys that can help us to understand it. I imagine a judge who every court case that comes to him, he lets the person go. The corporation that robbed and stole from a bunch of people, they're let go. They don't have a sentence. The person that stole and hurt that person on the side of the road, they're free. They can go, no punishment at all. The person that harmed you, they can go free. That person would be loved by those people. But the people that were hurt, the people that were harmed, they would be distraught. Amen. The person that just harmed them, the person that killed their loved one, is now walking away free. God's saying, I may be a God of mercy. I may be a God of love and forgiveness. But that doesn't mean keep going the way you want to. That doesn't mean keep going down sin. He says, this transition is key. But who by no means clear the guilty? That helps us, but to the innocent children? To the children and the children's friends? Like, I get the first part, right? Clear the guilty of the fathers. Yes, right? If you did this crime, you pay the time, right? That's a common saying. But not the children's children. The children shouldn't grow up doing the time. Why does it go to the children's and the children's children? We understand how much influence our parents have on us. Many of us grow up thing, I will never be like my dad. I will never be like my mom. I'm never, right, they raised me this way, but I'm not going to raise my kids that way. And eventually you grow up a little bit and you start noticing a lot of those characteristics that you found annoying in your parents. You're saying the same catchphrases that they said. You're acting just like them. And we understand there's a major influence on it. We understand that when your parents struggle with addiction, when your parents struggle with alcohol, that you are more likely to struggle with addiction yourself. When we begin to look at sin, not as something, a mistake, but more of as a disease, we understand that it gets passed on. Yes. Our parents' mistakes can often be ones that are very easy for us to fall into ourselves. I don't think this is a promise from God, saying, I promise you, if you mess up, I'm going to keep punishing you and your children and your children's children. It's not a promise, but a warning. He's saying, I'm not going to by no means clear the guilty. I will be a forgiving God. Look at the scale. I will forgive thousands, but I will warn you that sin is pervasive. Sin is a disease that continues to go on, and I want to get rid of it completely. If you keep going your ways, if you keep going in your father's ways, if you fall into the same traps as they are, right, you will be held liable to that. He says, I will not clear the guilty. He says, I am a God of love. I am a God of forgiveness. But you don't abuse that forgiveness. Don't abuse that mercy. Don't think you can go doing whatever you want. Come to me and I will forgive you. I will show you my steadfast love. And when Moses heard this, his only response was to quickly bow his head toward the earth and worship. In the book Education, we see when we are able to comprehend the character of God as did Moses, we too shall make haste to bow in adoration and praise. When we know who God is, when we learn about him for the first time, when we understand his character, our only response is to bow down in praise and adoration, to give our lives to him and say, Lord, I'm unworthy. Lord, you have revealed yourself to me, and you are an amazing, amazing God. To know God casts away all fears. When we see God as a merciful, compassionate, slow to angry God, we don't need to fear. He has the best for us. He loves us. Sometimes it takes a lot of time to learn this, to know this, to understand who God is. It's something we have to practice each and every day. 2 Peter 3:18 says it this way, but grow in grace and knowledge. Grow in it. Develop your knowledge more and more. Learn more about God, of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and to the day of eternity. Amen. Amen. Grow in grace and knowledge. Practice learning more about God. Develop your relationship with him. Because as we learn to know God, as we know who he is, it casts out fear in our lives. But just like we said in the beginning, knowing doesn't always get rid of fear. Many of us know God. We have a relationship. We spent time learning who he is. Yet many of us still struggle with fear. Many of us live in constant fear. We read verses like Philippians 4, 6, or 7, don't be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. We read these verses, but we struggle still with fear. We struggle with giving away our anxiety. Don't be anxious about anything. Give everything to the Lord. This is a major task for us. We can know who God is, but we need to work and practice applying that knowledge to our lives so that we can eventually become no longer anxious. I think all of us would dream of the day where we wake up, no stresses in your life. You've given it all to God, you wake up, just total peace, right? And we probably experience that at some times in our lives, but to live your life in that way, to live your life fully trusting God, saying, God, I don't need to stress about tomorrow, for tomorrow has its own troubles. Lord, I don't need to stress about this, for you love me, for you care for me. Lord, I don't need to be anxious at all. It'd be a dream for many of us. And God says you can do it, but it takes time. It takes practice applying what you know about God. Here at Puyallup, this is our mission, to know Jesus, to learn about God, to understand him, and then apply what we know, to share his love, to know Jesus and share his love, to put into practice what we know. And this is a continuing cycle as we do it. As you learn more about Jesus, you begin to trust him more and more. Okay, God, you say you're merciful. You say you're compassionate. You say you are a God of steadfast love, slow to anger. Let me test you on that. Let me put my knowledge of you to the test. God, I give you this part of my life. And we see him answer it. And we begin to say, wow, God, you answered my prayer in this way. God, you fulfilled what you said was true. And you made it true in my life. Lord, I've learned more about you, and you learn more, and you begin to share more, you begin to practice more, and it continues on and on. And there will be times, like Bob talked about, where you give thanks to God, but you don't quite get the answer you want, right? You get a no. You get maybe wait 40 years or so, and that can lead to lots of anxiety, lots of tension, I imagine, in your life, which is where the knowledge comes so important. God, I don't understand what you're doing here. But I know you're a good God. I know that you have the best in mind for me. Amen. Lord, I want to give it all to you through prayer, through supplication, just like Jason talked about last week, giving it all to prayer, spending time in prayer, developing and practicing knowing God, being in a relationship with him, so that we will not be anxious about anything as a church, that we will continue to know God. Just as Paul says it best in Philippians 3:10, I want to know Christ. I want to know Christ. Yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participate in the suffering, becoming like him in his death. I want to know Christ. May this be our desire as a church. May this be our passion, to know Jesus. Amen. And then to become like him, to share his love, to become like him even in his death and suffering, to know Jesus and to share his love. Jesus fulfilled so many of who he said he was. When God says, I am merciful, I am compassionate, we see so many examples of those through Jesus and his life. I think one of the clearest examples of this for me is the Last Supper. In John 13:3-7, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from the God and was going back to God. Jesus knew that he came from God. Jesus knew that God had given everything into his hands. With that knowledge, he rose from supper. He laid aside his outer garment and taking a towel, he tied it around his waist. And then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with a towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, Lord, do you want to wash my feet? Jesus answered him, what I am now doing, you do not understand, but afterward you will understand. God, Jesus, about to be betrayed by his family, about to be sold to the enemy, about to be hurt in ways we can't imagine, knowing all of this, knowing that he came from God, showed that he is merciful, showed that he is compassionate, showed that he was willing to humble himself to those around him, showed that he fulfilled what he said he was. He says, I am who I am. And Jesus here is showing that still. He says, I am who I said it was. I will always be who I am. I am who I am. And he fulfills this perfectly. And sometimes who God is doesn't make sense to us. Sometimes it can be scary to give our all to him. We can be like Simon Peter, you want to wash my feet? Lord, my feet are dirty. Lord, I didn't take a shower this morning. My feet are dirty. I have some toenail fungus, right? I have some dark parts of my life, Lord. I don't want to expose it all to you. Lord, I'll give you most of my life. But Lord, this part, I don't think you'll love me anymore if you know this part of my life. It can be scary to allow God to know you fully. It can be scary to be that open and exposed to God, just as it can be scary for us to allow each other into our inner lives, to allow to get to know one another. It can be scary. We can fear rejection. We can fear that person won't like us. It can be scary to be in a community where you are one together, where you are one church body. And so in doing and knowing what we are to do, Jesus, he gave us this example, and he says that you should do it just as I have done it to you. Practice what you know. He says, truly, truly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. Amen. We have a mission here at this church, to know Jesus and to share his love. Amen. To share his love means you are a part of a community. You cannot share love when you are in a vacuum, when you are by yourself. Here as a church, we are dedicated and passionate about knowing God and sharing his love as one. And so to be an example, to help with this, I want to know each and every one of you better. You may notice that there is a little paper in front of you in your seats and a little pencil. And I want to know you better. And so if you are willing and if you would be okay, I would like to come and visit you, to spend time getting to know you a little better, so you can fill this out if you would like. You can put your name, your address, and you can put if you want me to stop by just any time during the day or if you'd prefer me to call ahead of time or text ahead of time. Because I want to know each and every one of you better. I want to get rid of some of the fears of being in a community, to know each other and to grow closer with God together. as we grow closer with one another, we can share our struggles, share how God has answered our prayers. We can share what we know about God and together grow closer with Him. Together as a community, as a church, know Jesus and share His love. Along with this, today is our chance to put and do an example of what Christ had made an example for us. We can allow us to do it just as He said to do. So today we are going to have communion. We are going to be doing foot washing just pretty soon. So we will be going to different rooms. The couples and families can go to the gymnasium. The women can go to the library, and the men will be in the primary Sabbath school room. And we'll have a chance to know that we should be doing this, that God has given us this example, and we have a chance to do it today. It may be a little awkward to have someone maybe you don't know to wash your feet, to go through this process, to humble yourself, to be exposed in this way. It may be a little awkward, maybe a little uncomfortable, but we are told by Jesus that you know you should do this. Blessed are you if you do them. We are told by God, just a little bit later in this verse, by this all people will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. And so in this process of doing this, we show our love for each other. We show our need for community. And so I want to pray before we are dismissed to go do foot washing. You don't have to do it. It's not required. We're not going to force you to do it. If you feel too uncomfortable, you can remain in here, and there will be some soft music playing. But I encourage you to try this out, to practice what you know to do, and to try growing closer with God together. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, you are an amazing God, Lord, and we're so grateful to know who you are, to know you are a God of mercy, a God that is slow to anger, a God that has steadfast love forever, that nothing we can do will change that, that you are who you say you are, and we can believe and trust in you. And so, Lord, as we grow in our knowledge of you, we ask that you will help us to apply that, to live a life knowing you, trusting in you, not being anxious because we know you are a good Father who watches out for us, allowing ourselves to fully be in one with you. And Lord, we just pray that you will continue to guide us and lead us and show us that we as a church are in the presence of you, that you are with us, and that we will be distinct because of that presence, that we will live a different life because you are here with us, Lord. And so I just pray that you will continue to guide us as we remember the sacrifice you did for us. Remember and know that you love us, Lord, and that you will pay. You had paid the ultimate price for us. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
I think there's nothing quite like sharing a meal with your family, with friends and loved ones. And while this isn't the biggest meal, I think what it represents and what it points us to is just as important. And so here at Puyallup with the Seventh-day Adventist Church, we practice open communion so everyone can partake. But we do ask that you take this seriously. We are doing this in remembrance of Christ for his sacrifice, remembering the Last Supper he had with his disciples, with his family, saying the importance of this bread and these juice and these emblems. And so as we go through this communion service, I ask that you reflect on your own heart, that you, if you have any disagreements with friends, if you know there's some pain in your life that you've caused someone or anything like that, that you reflect on that, that you give your life to God, that you say, God, I want to serve you. I want to fully devote myself to you. And this can be in remembrance of that. And it can remind us that we know his love, that we know he loves us, that he sacrificed it all for us. And so as we remember that sacrifice today, I invite you to partake in communion in our service with us. So Elder Ken will talk about some of the bread and bless it for us.
What a privilege it is to be a part of this sacred service. I'm just humbled that my Savior Jesus would have left heaven and had his body broken if it was just for me. And he would have done the same if it was just for you. But I don't think it was as easy as we sometimes think. He was God and he chose to leave heaven, but once he'd been on earth and he was in human body and human form and he'd been here 33 years and he'd seen people crucified on a Roman cross, he knew. He knew what he was facing. And when you read the story in the Garden of Gethsemane and you realize the anguish he was in, and he was praying. I remember the disciples, they fell asleep and didn't pray with him. And he was praying. I don't know. I think there's different opinions on what Jesus could see in the future. Because he was human and yet God. But I like to believe when he was in prayer that an angel of heaven came to him and encouraged him. Because he was asking, is there another way? Is there another way? And I believe an angel came and spoke to him and told him, helped him see down the path of time and see each of you sitting here this morning. And the angel said, let me tell you about this guy named Johnny. Let me tell you about this woman named Billy. Let me tell you about this guy named Christos. Let me tell you about this woman named Mary. About this guy named Ken. And Jesus decided he could do it. He could go through with it. And his body was broken and battered and bruised for you and for me. And that's what this bread represents. So I just invite you to bow your heads and thank him for his sacrifice with me. Dear Jesus, thank you so much for what you have done for me, for each one of us here this morning, for choosing to have your body broken, battered, bruised and abused. And this example that you gave us, reminding us that when we break this bread, we are remembering the sacrifice for what you have done for us, that we are conquerors through you and your broken body. Thank you, and we praise you this morning in your name. Amen.
This morning, I was listening to some music, and a song came on, There is a Fountain. And I want to read just the little bit of that. There is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. Amen. Blood does not make things pure and white, except the blood of Jesus is different.
Amen. Amen.
I also with the blood thought about when God gave the Israelites the regulations for their sacrifices. He told them to drain all the blood off and don't eat the blood. Offer the blood up to God, because the blood is the life, and life belongs to God only. But then, when Jesus came, and he became the perfect sacrifice, and he did not just allow us to shed his blood, he willingly gave his blood. And he said, you know, don't just take it over you to cleanse you, but take it inside you. Take my life inside you. I give my life so that you can have life. And the only way that we can have life is by taking on the lifeblood of Jesus. Just bow your heads with me. Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for giving your Son and for him giving his blood of life for us, so that even though we only deserve death, we can have life and have life eternally with you. And as we drink this grape juice and we remember that it symbolizes his blood,
yeah,
just impress on our hearts and our minds just how meaningful that is, how much you love us, how much you have done for us, and fill us with your life and with your Spirit. Let us live our lives completely for you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen.
As we pass out the emblems, there will be a short time for testimonies. If you would like to share what is going on in your life, share how you know God's love, share anything about God, a short period of time will be allowed for that. We have someone with a mic if you would like to just raise your hand or signal him in some way. As we also pass them out, we also have a gluten-free option if you would like. We have that available. You can make another symbol, maybe raise your hand for one, left hand for the other one, to signify it, and we'll get you accommodated. So.
says in 1 Corinthians 11, 23. This is Paul speaking here. For this is what the Lord himself said, and I pass it on to you just as I received it. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.
In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me.
It is truly a privilege for me and a joy to be a part of this church body. And as we celebrate the communion today, as we remember Christ's sacrifice for us, we rejoice that he is coming soon, that we know that we are soon to be reunited with him, with our family and our loved ones in heaven. So it is my prayer that as a church, we will know Christ, we will have eternal life with him, and that we will share his love. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we cannot comprehend the sacrifice you made for us, the fact that you would go through it, the pain, the suffering, the betrayal and the hardship for us, for each and every one of us. Lord, it is beyond comprehension. We cannot understand the things you are willing to do for us. Lord, you are an amazing God, a God of mercy, compassion, a God of steadfast love. And Lord, we are just so thankful for who you say you are, that we can trust that who you say you are, that you will always be, and that you will always love us and care for us and desire for us to know you, to be in a relationship with you. And so Lord, it is our prayer today as a church. Lord, we want to know you. We want to share your love, and we desire to constantly grow closer with you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.